praise God. Let's have some testimonies this morning from the members of you here in the audience. Praise God of what God has done for you lately. Maybe change some impossible situations to possible. Praise God. God can do wonders for you, sister. Amen. Come on. God bless. Give us your brief testimony on how great the Lord has been in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. May the Lord receive some of your people.
Most of you know my testimony, but I'm still progressing to be healed completely. I had 4 back surgeries, and I don't have to wear a brace. I don't have to walk with my cane. Okay, so I'm praising God every day. So yesterday, I came to prayer, and it was glorious. It was great. So and then I came to practice. Then I came back from marriage counseling, but it was good all of it, all day long.
All day long.
All day long. All day long.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. The Lord is able to do exceedingly abundantly from all we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Any of you have testimonies of the goodness and miracle, mercy of God? Hallelujah. Amen. Sister Deborah, come tell us what's going on. Amen. 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 Amen.
I prayed and thanked y'all for being here this morning. Yeah. I told my husband every now and then I do a drive-by, y'all. I do a drive-by, I'll sit in the back, just get a little bit. This morning he said, oh, praise him some for me. So I'm glad to be here this morning. I thank and praise God for my family. You all don't know how much you have blessed me. I have one little sister and she lives somewhere else. So it's been a blessing to have family. I don't know how people do it by themselves. You can't do it by yourself. That's why God put us all together. And I thank God for all the calls and all the emails and all the attention that we've gotten. I must say that Brother Beauty is doing well. You know, no matter what we see, he's doing well. And even this past week, when we go to labs one day, then we go to chemo another day. So during labs, you visit with the doctor just kept looking at it. I said, all right. You know, because we're claiming complete deliverance and an opportunity to give the testimony. It's got to be something good in this. And so she kept looking at him, and I said, well, he's got a cough. So I was thinking it was the disease, and she said, I don't know, it must be sinuses. I was like, praise God. She said, I don't hear anything in his lungs, and you know, he's not lost. He's lost weight, but he needs to do that. So he's not lost a lot of weight, but he's a big guy. So we praise God for that. In the last couple weeks, he's been hungry. Praise God for that. I mean, like something passed. I need something to cover all his pills and medication. It's like he's picking out what he wants. And he can't fish, but God sent his buddy to come by just caught some, and he had all his pictures of all these crappie. I was like, oh, here we go. Because he'd be fishing in his sleep. So the buddy came by and brought him, and I said, well, just freeze it since we're having a hard time catching up, and chemo was this time, and come back and do this. And he said, no, I want him to have it fresh. So he took the time to drive it over, and he lives way over here somewhere. To drive them over so that they would be fresh. And I thank God he just gives you what you want. He's just an awesome God. And I know you guys have been going through marriage training, seminar, class. And it came to my mind, you know, when you come to the altar, I don't care how you come down, you can dance down, you can do all the fancy, walk the aisle to the front. When you say those vows, and a preacher says, we don't take this lightly, you don't. And I'm talking from experience, because I was almost comedy, and He had to wear somebody else's shoes that were too little, and you know, all these things that we got through it. My mother kept saying, you know, y'all have to be proper and correct in a wedding. But when you say those vows, till death do us part, it's more important than you ever know. Because if you have that opportunity, and some of you have, you've been caregivers and all that, and I thank God for giving me the opportunity to even retire so I could be in the right place at the right time. And I think that has been important as well. And he's just made ways. You know, funds, you know, I got so I just had to quit worrying about it. Lord, you are my source, and you tell me what to do. And I've asked you to teach me how to take care of him. But when you say to death do you part, there's more to that than you'll ever know. If you ever get in a position, I think we know more about each other in parts than we ever thought that we would. But God is able, and we believe that, and we're holding fast to the confession of our faith. And so, we've got family that's checking on us, and I appreciate you for all the things that you've done. I'm not going to, like Sister Hill, I'm not going to call names because you're going to miss somebody, and I don't intend to offend, and I know we're in your prayers because the doctor just looks at it. He's like, he keeps trying to give him medicine. I know you don't feel good, and you can't go through that pain. And we're both going, what's she talking about? I am not there. So I appreciate God today. I love him more than ever. I love him. And we just praise God for you and just continue to pray for us till we bring a full report. We are convinced. I told somebody, y'all gonna look up and we just gonna be the next.
Amen. This is about that young man sitting back there in the booth, operating the booth today, Jayton Stewart. On last Wednesday, he attended a Black Men's Summit. He was one of 10 young men that was picked from his school, Memorial High School. It was a statewide summit held at OCU University in Edmond, Oklahoma. Did I get it right? Yeah. I think it was Oklahoma Central University or something like that. But it was a statewide summit for young Black high school young men, and he was one of 10 from Memorial High School that was selected to go. So I'm really proud of him, you know, for being one of the few to be chosen. And also, this coming weekend, we'll be in Duncanville, Texas, for a football camp. You know, so I'm proud of him for able to combine sports and academics and keeping them both at a level where, you know, he's getting attention, you know, from all over. So I'm proud of him, and y'all done a wonderful job with him, nurturing him and helping me out to keep him on the right track. So I thank you, I'm proud of him, and I'm proud of all of you. Amen. Okay, is this Kenny? Okay. This is Kenny's, Bailey's sister.
Thank you, Jesus. I'm glad to be here this morning and just felt led to share my testimony. I've been through a lot since you all seen me. But the testimony I want to tell about, in 2012, I was diagnosed with cancer. And I came here to Tulsa and went to the doctor, and he told me, and, you know, I've been in the Word a long time, and there ain't no place for fear. And so when he gave me that diagnosis, I was like, okay. But what he didn't understand was my mom had cancer, and was given no chance hardly to live. And in 3 weeks, she was back at work part-time. In 6 weeks, she was back home. She went on to retire. 30 years has passed, and she's healthy and cancer-free. So I already knew that God is in here. I already knew what the Lord could do. So, but I went and got my cousin, and who lives here, and I brought her because I wanted a witness. You know, because when you start telling about miracles, people think you're crazy. I wanted somebody, a witness, to be able to verify that I wasn't making this thing up. So she went, and they did a CT scan, and she saw it, and they showed where the cancer was inside the kidney. And they were telling me there's only one blood vessel to the kidney, and where this was located, it would be a good chance they would damage that blood vessel, and if they did, they would have to remove that kidney. But of course, you can live with one kidney. But God made me whole, and He wanted to keep me whole. So I showed her, and so we were walking out. I said, now you fixing to see that God is a miracle worker, because I know. So I came here for Tulsa for the surgery. The surgery lasted several hours longer than it was supposed to. And now Candy was there, and my mom was there, when the doctor came in and said the reason it lasted so long was because when they went in to get it, they couldn't find it. And so then they spent all this time trying to search how it got out of there. Because there was no openings, there was no cuts, there was nothing, they couldn't find it. But they found another tumor outside of the kidney. Well, that couldn't be it because it couldn't have gotten out of there. So then they called and had them send the records. Now I'm opened up on the table. They call and they go send for the records. And they go and they look at the measurements and they measure the one that's outside, and it's the same exact size and shape of the one, but they spent all this time trying to figure out how it got out of there. So then the news to me when I woke up was that it wasn't in there, but where it was, most likely cancer would have spread through my whole bloodstream. But they sent it off to the lab. That next day I got a phone call. They said, well, we just haven't seen anything quite like this before, but the cancer was capsulated, meaning that a ring grew around it that stopped it from spreading into the bloodstream. When I went back for my 4-week checkup, he said, you don't have nothing to worry about. If you got a family member that needs a kidney, your kidney function is better than the average American. He said, you can give a kidney to somebody if you want to. Now, I'm saying that to say this. It don't matter what the report is. You know, the Bible says, who shall believe our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Who's going to believe our report? You can believe whatever you want to believe. You can believe what man tells you. You can believe what family say. You can believe what anybody else say and what science says. But when you put your trust in the Word of God, the Bible says the world endures forever. That was here in the beginning. It's going to be here in the end. Heaven and earth is going to pass away. But the Word of God is going to endure forever. And if you stand up on this Word, if you believe this Word, if you take this Word to heart, hide this Word in your heart like they were singing, and walk for God, there's nothing impossible. There's nothing He won't do.
Oh, my God.
lift your hands and say, praise the Lord. Amen. I just want to, just before we have the main message together, a short message. What's the word? Is Brother Marino here? Yeah, he is a motivational speaker, and he has something on his heart. In the last 2 months, God has really began to work in the area of finances. So I think that we can get God working financially and through healing and through spiritual edification and all that God is doing through the Word, I think that we will be able to do a lot more. And I just want you to hear how God has opened doors for him. This has been kind of burning on his heart, but recently there have been some miraculous things. I want him to come because he's here on Tuesday and Thursday at 5 o'clock. A.M. All right, and he's been doing this for years. And you, when you hear what God, how many doors God has opened and what God has done, how God has raised him up and given him a huge breakthrough, you can see that God is faithful even in the area of supplying all I need. Amen. So we're going to have him to come not only on Tuesdays and Thursdays, but he can't be here on Wednesdays, but nights. But he does Bible study on a one-on-one on Wednesday. So that 3 days a week, he's very, very committed and amen and consistent. So he's going to tell you with his own testimonial how God has opened doors and amen, and he has become one of the strongest supporters of this ministry, and much of what God is able to do has been largely because of when we got him saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, he hit the ground running. God bless you, brother.
Amen.
Praise God to
everybody. Take a few seconds to kind of get my thoughts together here. Okay, I'm gonna go back 25 years, maybe even longer, maybe 27, something like that. I'm 42 now, so when I was a teenager, the school system wrote me off. I'm just gonna be honest with you. I was one of those kids, they wouldn't say much, because of the things I went through in my life, parents, and by the way, me and my parents have a good relationship now, but I was one of those kids that y'all see, I hate to use the word bus kids, but some of the kids that we pick up on Sundays, that was pretty much me and my brother. And it was hard. That's why my heart goes out to those kids. About 25 to 27 years ago, the school system wrote me off because I was real quiet, wouldn't say nothing, so they labeled me, knowing that, I know I'm very intelligent, but when you're quiet, people don't see that. So moving forward, I ran into my grandfather. I met my grandfather around that time, about 15, 16 years old, and I knew of him. He had this strong business. He had several things going for himself. He had good accounts with FM merchants, those people, the Wheelers, those big time business owners back in that time. He got established through them. So when I met him, I guess he saw something in me. And he kept saying, college is not for everybody, and you don't have to go to school to be a millionaire. And so I'm listening to him like, because at that time, the Cosby Show and the Different World and all that stuff was promoting that pretty heavy. So I'm listening to him. I'm like, wow, you don't have to go to school to become these things. And he was teaching me the things about what Dave Ramsey is teaching back then, and I caught on to it when I came here. Wow. Passive income and put your money in places, let it work for you. And when I started making money with him, he was telling me, hey man, you need to invest your money into little properties around here in North Tulsa. But when you come up poor, you want to splurge on jeans, guest jeans at the time, Jabot, just different vehicles. I wasn't catching it. So He was telling me, man, if you listen to me now, by the time you're 30, you'll be self-sufficient. I started listening to him later, but I needed to get them little clothes and little material things out the way first, you know what I'm saying? Let me get what I ain't got, you know? So I started listening to him, and he started showing me how can you make money without being present. So when you're a kid, you really don't catch on to those things until you grow up. That's why I'm still instilling those things to my kids now. So by the time they 13, 14 years old, they're gonna caught the bug. But anyway, so I started listening to him and doing these things. And so eventually I went out on my own and started trying to do stuff, but didn't have God in my life. So I'm trying these things and trying these things and trying these things, but it never worked. He used to always say, hey, you need to put God first. Again, I'm a teenager, hormones are racing, doing all of those, you know, just things like that. So I kept ignoring that. Fast forward, let me see, maybe 8 years later, that's when I came here. So that's when it got serious. So he was telling me about, hey, you need to put God first, and wasn't listening to all that. So when I came here, I started hearing that same song again. I'm starting singing. And then I'm starting to see what Pastor Hill and Sister Hill and everybody's preaching, and my father-in-law, everybody's preaching. So then I started listening to that. I said, you know what? I know my grandfather taught me this business stuff, but it's not working to have the knowledge. So let me go ahead and try this Christian thing and see what this is about. I mean, it's more to it to the story. I mean, I can go on, you know, to meet my wife, but I'm gonna talk about this. So I said, I'm gonna try this. So when Pastor Hill started talking about tithing and giving, I'm thinking to myself, just give whatever, you know, here and there. And once I learned about it, my wife had to sit me down and talk and show me and teach me, really show me what that really meant, because I really didn't have an understanding of it. So once I got the revelation of that, I went full-fledged with it. Wow. I started understanding the word, getting taught, and going to prayer, going, you know, doing a little bit of fasting. I haven't conquered that yet. I'm gonna be honest with y'all. I'm still working on how to fast completely, but that's okay. You know. So I started learning about tithing and giving and freeing up your time, volunteering through Young Life with my friend Derek. All these different things I started doing. And it created a discipline to me. It created a discipline and some and I started liking it. So one, you know, God started showing up in my life. He started meeting those needs. I'm like, wow, I'm liking this. So then all of a sudden one day he brought back to my remembrance, the opportunity came for me to get into this business that I'm in now. And all the things that my grandfather had taught me, it's like I put it into that business along with the word of God. So then, once I started doing that, doors just started opening. Then we went through Purity with Purpose. Then we went through, and then the opportunity for, Tuesday morning, Thursday morning prayer, and all these different things that Pastor Hill was offering. So I really got stuck in that. You know, then we stopped for a while, and I brought it back up. But here recently, I'm all over the place, so stick with me. So here recently, God started opening up doors. I started going back to prayer and started bringing that back up. And in the last 3 to 4 months, God has grown our company, I'm going to say at least 12, 13%. And that's kind of huge in business. Yeah. Wow. Somewhere up in there. And it's all because the sacrifices that we're making. It's hard getting up 2 o'clock, 4:30 in the morning because you got to be here at 5. And then you got to work and do other things throughout the day. It's hard. It's hard doing that. It takes a sacrifice. It takes a discipline. And I believe that if people get on board with these disciplines, God starts showing up in your life in areas that you didn't think he would show up in. As far as tithing, never stopped. Giving, never stopped. I think that's the serious breakthrough of our company is giving. That's very major. I encourage everybody to give. Don't even think about it. The 10% ain't even yours anyway. Might as well just say 13% because you gotta give on top of that. You know, and that's what we done went. I wish I could share numbers here, but we got about 20-something employees, about 22, something like that. But I've hired hundreds. And keep in mind, y'all, it started with $1,500 investment.
Amen.
You know, we started this company with $1,500, my last $1,500. You know, 12, 13 years ago. I was like, wow. I saw the vision, prayed about it, told my wife about it. We was in agreement.
Yeah.
And I said, this is it. We got to make this work because we was doing other things. And God just opened up doors.
Yes.
And now, you know, I don't worry about money anymore. So. You know, not saying that I can't still make it, but I don't expect that. I'm on other things now. So I just praise God. I give God all the glory. I am a miracle, to be honest with y'all. You know, I stopped living with my parents when I was 10 years old. My grandmother finished raising me and my brother. So it was, I had to deal with that issue. So I just encourage everybody to just stay focused, stay motivated. And I tell you what, tithing creates a discipline in you as well.
Yes, yes, yes.
It creates a discipline in you. I advise everybody to get just discipline breeds wealth, I believe, you know.
Yes.
So I just encourage everybody to just keep doing what you do. And also my clients, let me see. Bank First, been having them for years. My son is what, 9 going on 10, but have it not that long. All my accounts that I've had, a lot of years, longevity, and that's the key, longevity in the banks. In the banks, I used to have dealerships, but I kind of stay away from them now. But I have some plants, we have schools, we have, financial equipment companies. We have a lot of different accounts. We have 40 something close, about between 45 and 50 different, you know, people, buildings that we service. So, but like I say, God gave me that I give it all to Him. You know, only credit I give myself is making up my mind to walk in this light. You know, because God gives us free will. So I had to say I got to do this, but it was God who provided, you know, made this happen. So, you know. Anything else you want me to say, Pastor? I can go on, but I know we're on the time deal, so I had to kind of chop edit a little bit.
Yeah, you can edit it, because I tell you, I was funny because that is probably, you would have.
How did you get your house?
Yeah, no, since, me and my wife was looking for a house, and we didn't know where to live at. And then we was kind of looking in the area that. But anyway, Sister Hill turned us on to where we stay at now, and Sister Tia, they kind of gave us the inspiration to do that. And once that happened, God gave that was like confirmation. So I was like, wow, that, you know, and I thank her for that. You know, yeah. And anything else you want to say?
All right. Now,